Hello, this is Akram Jafar, and in this video I'm going to deal with some picture tests and practical anatomy of the lower limb. The video deals with the posterior compartment of the leg and sole of the foot. You may use the video as a revision or as a self-assessment tool. For the purpose of self-assessment, pause the video and spend some time to read the question and come up with the answer, then replay the video to confirm your answer by listening to the comments and explanations. A 35-year-old woman presented with a sudden severe pain at the back of her ankle while participating in a beach volleyball match, which ankle appearing in the picture is abnormal. Now this ankle here, the right one, looks normal. You can see the Achilles tendon here, but on this side, it looks abnormal. The reason for that is that the Achilles tendon has been torn. Achilles tendon, or tendocalcaneus, is the common insertion of the triceps suri muscle, formed of soleus and the two heads of gastrocnemius muscle, and it's attached to the posterior aspect of the calcaneus. If we palpate this region when the tendon is torn, then a gap can be felt, and the patient will have difficulty plantar flexing the foot. Identify vessels A and B. Where would you feel for the pulsations of each? This is an angiogram in a lateral view of the leg and foot, and you can see anteriorly is the anterior tibial artery here, which continues as the dorsalis pedis artery, can be felt on the dorsum of the foot, just lateral to the tendon of extensor hallucis longus, while this one is the posterior tibial artery, and you can see here that it passes behind the medial malleolus and the tarsal tunnel. These are its terminal branches, medial and lateral plantar arteries. So this is the posterior tibial artery, which can be felt behind the medial malleolus. Identify the artery A, name its two terminal branches, and identify the tendon B. The artery is located on the medial side of the ankle joint behind the medial malleolus. Look at the big toe here. This is the medial side, and this is the posterior tibial artery. Note the accompanying nerve, the tibial nerve. Both of them are splitting here, the artery and the nerve, into medial plantar artery and lateral plantar artery, medial plantar nerve, and lateral plantar nerve. Many muscles have been dissected here and been removed, so we can see here a very deep structure that crosses from the lateral to the medial side of the sole of the foot. This is the tendon of peroneus longus muscle. Usually it is bridged by the long plantar ligament, which has been cut and dissected here. Identify the anatomical structure that is being surgically removed in this patient. This is the plantar aponeurosis, thickening of the deep fascia of the sole of the foot. The deep fascia on the sole of the foot is thickened centrally while it is thin on the sides, lateral and medial side. It is important to support the longitudinal arches of the foot. It is important to protect the sole of the foot. But sometimes straining and inflammation of this plantar aponeurosis might result in pain on the plantar surface of the heel that is not relieved unless the fascia is removed. In this dissection of the back of the ankle, which of the numbered muscles act on the big toe? Which muscles are attached to the tarsal bones? You can see the calcaneus here, and this is the Achilles tendon. It doesn't act on the big toe, but it acts on the tarsal bone, which is the calcaneus. These three muscles, they pass behind the medial malleolus of the tibia. Remember the mnemonic, Tom did a nice home. Tom is tibialis posterior, which grooves the bone, the tibia. Did digitorum, and here the muscles are flexors. So this is the tendon of flexor digitorum longus. And then H is hallucis, characterized by being fleshy down to the ankle joint, unlike the other muscles. They have less flesh. And the reason for that is this muscle should be very strong because it acts on the big toe, and the big toe is the takeoff point. It's the last point that pushes on the ground before takeoff. So it is the strongest of the deep flexor muscles. So number three is the muscle that acts on the big toe. The other muscles, tibialis anterior, doesn't act on the toes, but it acts on the tarsal bones. In fact, it's attached to the tuberosity of the navicular bone as well as the metatarsal, and it everts, as well as plantar flex the ankle joint, it everts the foot at the transverse tarsal joints because it's attached distal to the transverse tarsal joint. Number two is not attached to a tarsal bone. It's attached to the digits, to the phalanges. So 3 is attached to the big toe, 1 and 4 are attached to the tarsal bones. Which arteries are palpated in A and B? In A, the artery that is palpated is located on the dorsum of the foot, and as you can see, it is just lateral to the tendon of extensor hallucis longus. So this is the dorsalis pedis artery, distal to the malleoli. In B, this is the medial side of the ankle, behind the medial malleolus. This is the posterior tibial artery. Which cutaneous nerve is harvested as a graft in this location? This is the lateral side of the foot, and this is the lateral malleolus. Here we are behind the lateral malleolus. Behind the lateral malleolus, there is a superficial vein, which is the small saphenous vein, but there is a cutaneous nerve. The cutaneous nerve is the sural nerve, and this is usually harvested as a graft for other nerves because it is easily accessible, and at the same time, it's purely cutaneous, so its removal will not cause much damage. What nerve is tested when asking the patient to do a toe stand, as shown in the picture? In this case, we are asking the patient to do plantar flexion, and in this case, we are using the muscles of the posterior compartment of the leg. These muscles are supplied by the tibial nerve. So the nerve tested is the tibial nerve. The deep fibular nerve, option B, supplies the muscles of the anterior compartment, and in this case, we would ask the patient to dorsiflex the foot instead of plantar flexing. The superficial peroneal supplies the lateral compartment of the leg, and in this case, we would ask the patient to evert the foot to confirm the action of peroneus longus and brevis. Inferior gluteal nerve supplies the gluteus maximus muscle, and this muscle is an extensor of the hip, in fact, powerful extensor of the hip, as well as lateral rotator. The superior gluteal nerve is supplying gluteus medius and minimus and the tensor of the fascia lati, these abductor muscles, and would be tested by asking the patient to stand on one side and looking at the hip on the contralateral side. If the hip dips on the contralateral side, then the gluteus medius and minimus on the stance side are affected and the nerve is affected. This is what we call Trendelenburg sign. Match each numbered bone with a lettered muscle attachment. Each number may be used once, twice, or not at all. The bones here is the talus and then the navicular bone. Here is the calcaneus, the bone that we stand on. And then we have the fifth metatarsal bone. This is the styloid process of the fifth metatarsal bone. And then here we have the first metatarsal bone. The other muscles which are not numbered are the cuneiform bones. This is the medial cuneiform. And here on the lateral side, this is the cuboid. Tibialis anterior is attached to the medial cuneiform and the first metatarsal. So tibialis posterior is attached to the navicular bone, number 2. Peroneus longus muscle comes from the lateral side, grooves the cuboid, and is attached to the base of the first metatarsal, just opposite to the attachment of tibialis anterior, as well as the medial cuneiform bone. Peroneus brevis muscle is attached to the styloid process of the fifth metatarsal bone. Gastrocnemius muscle, as well as soleus, they are attached to the calcaneus, forming the calcaneal tendon or tendo Achilles. So it's only the talus that has not been used. In fact, there is no muscle attached to the talus. They cross the talus, they groove the talus, but they are not attached to the talus. Identify the bone at the tip of the pointer, which muscle tendon occupies the groove close to it. Now this is an X-ray of the lateral side of the ankle and the foot. It shows the tibia fibula. This is the talus. You can see the trochlea of the talus, and this is the posterior process. Anteriorly is the head of the talus articulating with the navicular, and inferiorly is the calcaneus. Now, the posterior process of the talus usually is characterized by two tubercles, lateral tubercle and a medial tubercle, and in between them there is a groove. This groove is occupied by the tendon of flexor hallucis longus. So the flexor hallucis longus comes from the posterior compartment of the leg, grooves behind the talus, and then passes below the sustentaculum tali. It doesn't groove behind the tibia, The tendon that grooves behind the medial malleolus of the tibia is the tendon of tibialis posterior. Sometimes there is an accessory ossification center of the talus that does not fuse with the remaining part of the bone, and this results in the formation of a separate bone connected to the talus by cartilage or fibrous tissue. The bone is called os trigonum. It is a variant and should not be confused with a fracture of the talus. Which vein is varicose in A and B? Now in A, the varicose vein, as you can see it here, is located posterior to the leg, and it's clear that it comes from the lateral side of the foot behind the lateral malleolus, and then the varicosities end here in the popliteal fossa. So this is the small saphenous vein, which drains into the popliteal vein in the popliteal fossa. In this patient, you can see that the varicose vein is located on the medial side, look at the big toe here, medial side of the anterior aspect of the leg. And so this vein is going to continue upwards, medial to the knee, and this is the site of the long or great saphenous vein. This vein, the great saphenous vein, starts from the medial side of the dorsal venous arch, passes in the front of the medial malleolus, and then about a hand breadth posteromedial to the knee until it reaches the site of the femoral triangle, where it dips and perforates the deep fascia to end into the deep vein there, which is the femoral vein. Tarsal tunnel decompression identifies structures 1 to 4. The tarsal tunnel is located deep to the flexor retinaculum. You can see the flexor retinaculum here. This tunnel provides for the tendons and nerves and vessels to pass from the posterior compartment of the leg to the sole of the foot. It is comparable to the carpal tunnel, which allows the passage of structures from the flexor compartment of the forearm to the palm. If it causes compression of these structures, it is released. We can see some of these structures. We can see the one are the venae comitants that accompany the artery. The artery is the posterior tibial artery behind the medial malleolus, and it's accompanied by venae comitants, veins on both sides of the artery. This is a common situation for the peripheral arteries. They are accompanied by veins on either side, not a single vein, like the proximal veins. For example, the femoral vein and femoral artery, we don't have a venae comitans, we have a single artery, or the popliteal vein and the popliteal artery. But the anterior tibial, posterior tibial arteries, they are accompanied by venae comitans, a vein on either side. And then we have 3 is the nerve, which is the tibial nerve, which can be compressed here in the carpal tunnel. And 4, as I mentioned, is the flexor retinaculum itself. Of course, there are tendons of muscles, the 3 muscles of the deep compartment of the posterior aspect of the leg, tibialis posterior, flexor digitorum longus, and flexor hallucis longus with their synovial sheaths. Identify the muscles A and B, these 2 differences in their action. Note that this is a dissection of the back of the knee. This is the popliteal fossa. A is the lateral head of gastrocnemius. This is the medial head of gastrocnemius. I can say that this is the lateral side, not only because I have the sign here that this is the lateral side, but also I can see the common peroneal nerve here going laterally and downwards, accompanying the tendon of biceps femoris muscle, while here this is the tibial nerve. So this is the lateral side. Also arising in common with the lateral head of gastrocnemius muscle is the plantaris muscle, the muscle that has a very short belly and a long tendon here that looks like a nerve. This muscle is comparable to palmaris longus muscle in the upper limb. B is the soleus muscle. Look at the soleus. It arises from the soleal line of the tibia on the medial side. Then it crosses between the tibia and fibula. There is an arch deep to it, the posterior tibial artery and the tibial nerve passes, and then it goes to be attached to the fibula. Soleus and gastrocnemius, both of them are attached to the tendocalcaneus, and they constitute what we call the triceps suri muscle. Sura is the back of the leg. Both muscles through the tendocalcaneus, they plantar flex the foot at the ankle joint. But gastrocnemius also crosses the knee joint. It's attached to the condyles of the femur, and so it can flex the knee as well as it flexes the ankle joint. So this is one difference between them. The other difference is that the soleus muscle is a multipinnate muscle. And multipinnate muscles usually have multiple bipinnate muscles. They are bulky, they are, have a lot of muscle fibers. And so when they contract forcefully. As opposed to the gastrocnemius, which consists of parallel fibers. These parallel fibers, when they contract, they can produce more shortening than the multipinnate fibers of soleus, but they are less powerful. So the soleus is the powerful muscle that is used in plantar flexion to overcome the inertia at the beginning of the movement. And then gastrocnemius is going to take over, like the low gear and the high gear of the car. The low gear is represented by soleus, while the high gear is represented by gastrocnemius. So this is another difference in the action. The other difference here in the action is that soleus is the main muscle that acts as a peripheral heart, a peripheral pump, because it has a venous plexus in and around the muscle, and it is the main pump. Although gastrocnemius also participates in that, but it is the soleus muscle. That's why the muscle should be moved in long periods of immobility by plantar flexing the foot in order to push the venous blood toward the heart. Identify the structures A and B. Structure B is the tendon of flexor hallucis longus. You can see here that this tendon passes in between two muscles here. In fact, these two muscle groups of muscle fibers belong to one muscle, which is the flexor hallucis brevis. And flexor hallucis brevis, each tendon has a sesamoid bone attached to it. And so these sesamoid bone will prevent crushing of the tendon of flexor hallucis longus as it passes in between them. Each sesamoid bone receives not only the flexor hallucis brevis tendon, but also receives the tendon of another muscle. So on the medial side, it receives the tendon of abductor hallucis, and on the lateral side, it receives the tendon of adductor hallucis muscle.